Welcome to another installment of the RiotJS and Redux video series. If you haven't been following along, it will probably be much easier to start at the beginning, since each video builds on where the previous video left off. And remember, to get up to speed on Redux itself, you really can't beat the Egghead.io videos by Redux's creator, Dan Abramov. When we left off last time, we had added the ability to add a new task to our list, but a task list really isn't very useful if we can't check things off. So this time we're going to look at adding checkboxes and updating our items. So the first thing we're going to do is we're going to go into our task list.tag file, and we're going to add an input to each item in our loop, and that type will be a checkbox, and we're going to give it an ID of task.id. So we'll take the ID value that comes back from our API, and we'll use that as our input element's ID attribute. And we're going to add a checked attribute, and we're going to pass that an expression. And the value of that expression is going to be task.isComplete. And at this point, we don't have any isComplete properties on our tasks, so those will all default to false, and our checkboxes will not be checked. So at this stage, we can go into our browser, and we can refresh. And each of our items should show up with a checkbox, though that checkbox isn't going to do anything yet. So let's go back into task list, and I want to add an onChange attribute to the input, and I'm going to give that a value of handleCheck, which is a function we'll create right here in our task list file. So I'll add some script tags, and our handleCheck, which is going to accept the event. We're going to have this function call this.ops.handleCheck, which is going to be a function that's passed in from our to-do app tag. And we're going to pass the event's target.id, which is going to get the ID attribute of the checkbox, and a Boolean value that tells this handle checked function whether this was checked or unchecked. So now let's go into the to-do app tag. And we're going to add a handle task completion change function. And that's going to accept an ID and a flag called isComplete. And in that function, I'm going to call store.dispatch actions.toggleComplete. And I'm going to pass along the ID and the isComplete Boolean value. Now, this action doesn't exist yet. We'll get to that in a moment. In our task list tag, we want to pass in the handle check attribute and give it a reference to the function we just created. So this is going to wire up our checkbox change event to pass through to this function, which will then handle the store.dispatch call. So in actions.js, we're going to scroll to the bottom and we're going to add a toggle complete action creator. It's going to accept that ID and the isComplete Boolean. And toggleComplete is going to return a function. And this is our Redux thunk function. So it's going to accept dispatch and getState as arguments. And in this function, we're going to do an XHR request. And for this request, rather than doing a put and passing the entire task action, we're going to call patch. And we're going to call patch against the URL that's specific to the task that we're changing. And we're going to pass an updated value for isComplete. So this is going to have to be a call to localhost 3000 slash tasks slash whatever our task ID is. So in order to accomplish that, we could concatenate the string by calling localhost 3000 task and just using the plus operator to add the ID value that's passed into our function onto the end of that URL. But a better option is to use the ES2015 string interpolation syntax. So we're going to wrap our string in backticks, and we're going to pass in this dollar sign, double curly brace, and then inside the curly braces, we can pass in our ID value. So we pass in ID, which comes from the function's arguments in here, and this is going to create our string that'll map to localhost slash tasks slash one or two or whatever that ID value is. Now that we have that set up, we also need our request content type header. So we'll pass in content type application slash JSON. And we'll set up our request onload function to handle the response from this request. And when we send a request, we're going to pass that JSON.stringify. And we'll stringify an object that has our isComplete property with our isComplete value. And in our onload function, we'll add an if statement so that we can respond properly to successful requests. And when we get a successful request, we're going to dispatch an action. And that action is going to be complete changed. And we're going to pass along the ID and the isComplete Boolean. We don't have a complete changed action creator yet, so let's create it. So we'll create the function complete changed, and we'll pass in ID and isComplete. And complete changed is going to return an action object with a type task completion changed. And we'll pass it a data property with an object that represents our task update. So it'll have the task ID and that new isComplete value. Now that our action creator is set up, let's update our reducer to handle this case. We'll go back into index.js and we'll add a case for the task completion changed action. And this one's going to be a little more complicated than what we've done so far because we need to take a specific item out of the list, update it, and return a brand new state that represents the existing state with that change in its original place. So the first thing we're going to do is we're going to use the passed in ID from action.data, and we're going to get the task's index in our tasks array. So create a variable, task index, and we're going to assign it to state.tasks.findindex. Keep in mind that findindex isn't necessarily supported on all browsers, depends on what you have to support, but you can grab a utility library such as Lodash, where there will be an alternative that'll provide the same functionality. Findindex is going to take a function, and that's going to go through our task array. The first time that function returns a true, that'll be the index that gets returned. Now that we have the task index, we need to create a new array with the updated task in its original place, and that updated task has to have its new isComplete value. So we're going to start by creating the new tasks array, and we're going to start with a call to state.tasks.slice. We're going to pass slice 0 and our task index. And what this is going to do is return a new array with the values from 0 up to the index from our current tasks array. So if our task index is 0, it'll just return an empty array. And then we're going to use concat to add our updated task into this array. And then we're going to use another call to concat to add the rest of the array to the end. So the second concat call will call state.task.slice, and basically from one after the task index to the end of the array. For our target item, we're going to use object.assign, and we're going to take the item from our tasks array at our target index, and we're going to merge it with our isComplete property into a new object, and that gets passed back into concat. So this new tasks array will represent our newly updated array. So that takes care of our to-do items 2 and 3. And at the end of everything, we want to take our entire state, merge that into a new object with the updated tasks array, and return that from our reducer. All right, and to make sure this can run, I'm going to go back to actions.js. And I'm going to expose our action creator on our module.exports. So we'll add that toggle complete. And if we go to our browser and refresh, we should be able to update that. And we'll see in db.json that it's added that isComplete flag to both items that were checked. If I go back to the browser and uncheck one of those items, I can see again that the update took place. Now we have this working, but there's a better way to write this code. So let's go back to our reducer. And since we're running our code through Babel with Webpack, we can take advantage of some syntax that'll make this look a little bit nicer. So let's get rid of our comments just to clean this up a bit. And I want to take my call to new tasks where I'm using concat, and I'm going to comment that out just so we have it for reference. And I'm going to create a new variable, new tasks, and I'm going to set it to equal an empty array. And inside that array, I'm going to make my same call to state.task.slice from index 0 to whatever my task index is. And I'm going to tack on 3 periods to the beginning of that. And this is the spread operator. So this basically says take whatever this array is and spread it out into its individual values. So my array will now have individual items returned from task.slice, and then my next item will be my updated item based on task index, And then I can use that spread operator one more time to tack the items from the rest of the array into this new array. It'll work with either code. I prefer this. I think it's a little more concise, a little bit easier to read. And if we go back to our browser, we can verify that this still works. I'll just check all the items and take a look at db.json. And isComplete has been created and marked true on all of those items. If I go back into the browser, I can set the items to false by unchecking them. And I'm going to remove the commented out code and just keep the new refactored version of new tasks. So far, we've only focused on the happy path when everything goes right with our API. You should handle errors for all of your API calls, but we're going to focus on an error that occurs when we mark an item complete and we get an error back from the server. And the reason we're going to look at this one specifically is that if I check the box and there's some kind of an error on the server, the update isn't going to happen and we're not going to update our state, but the checkbox is going to remain checked. So we need to uncheck the checkbox if we get an error back, just to make sure that our UI actually represents the state of our application based on the response from the server. So I'm going to use a tool called Charles that will allow me to basically fake a 500 error from the server. Setting up Charles is a little bit outside the scope of this video, but maybe I'll do one in the future. But for now, I'm just going to open up my console. And I've set it up so that I get an error when I check the box on record video. And you'll see that I get a 500 error back from this patch. And that happens both when I check it or when I uncheck it. So we need to update our reducer, or I'm sorry, we need to update our action creator to account for this error and reset the UI to represent the current state of the application. So I'm going to go into actions.js. And in my toggle complete function, I want to add an else to this if statement. And in my else, I'm going to dispatch the same complete changed action that I dispatched on a successful response, but I'm going to negate the value of isComplete. And this will basically go through, update my state, and force the tag to refresh so that my checkbox, instead of remaining checked, unchecks itself in the case of an error. All right, so let's take a look at that in the browser. So we still have Charles running to fake this 500 error. I'm going to refresh to make sure my updated JavaScript is loaded. And when I check record video, see that I get an error, but it's also dispatching my task completion changed event with is completed false and the checkbox is unchecked immediately after checking it. Now this isn't super user friendly, because whoever checked that checkbox has no idea what just happened. So let's add an error message. So to do that, first thing I'm going to do is I'm going to go into my tags directory and I'm going to create a new file. We'll call that errormessage.tag. And as with any tag file, we're going to create our root tags and let's output our message. We'll throw that in a div and we're going to get our message through an attribute on the tag when we reference it. So we'll call this message. And we need an attribute to control our visibility. So we'll throw a show attribute on the div. And we're going to need to pass something into that expression. So we'll also create an attribute when we reference the tag called isError. And that'll get access through this.ops. So let's add this error message tag to our to-do app tag. And we're going to need to give that a message attribute. For now, we'll just hard code test message in there just to make sure this is working. And we're also going to need the isError attribute. And we'll pass this true for now so that it displays when we test it. And to make sure that works, let's go to our index.js file and add a require statement. And now that should be included in our bundle. So let's go back to the browser, refresh our page, and we should see our error message tag being displayed because we hard coded in our message and our visibility attribute. So let's make it work for real. So in our actions.js file, we're going to add an action creator called showError. And showError is going to accept a message. And we're going to return an object with the type showError and a data property with the value of the message. So we're going to handle this showError action in our reducer. So let's go back to index.js, and in our reducer, we'll add a case for the showError action. And in this case, we'll return object.assign, our existing state, plus an object that has our isError and our error message properties merged into a new object and returned as our updated state. And now that our reducer is set up to handle this, let's go into our to-do app tag. We'll update these hard-coded values that we put in. So we'll replace our message with an expression. And that expression is going to take this.state.error message. And where we have true is our hard-coded value for isError. Let's replace that with a call to this.state.isError. And with our tag properly configured, let's go back to actions.js and update our toggle complete action creator to dispatch our show error action. So we'll dispatch show error and we'll pass in the value API error. And let's take a look at that. Go back in the browser. I'm going to refresh and our error message tag should be hidden by default. And I'm going to check on record video and I'm going to get my 500 error back. It's going to show my error message. My checkbox stays where it was. And we're good, except now the error just stays forever. So let's take care of that. So back in actions.js, I want to create an action creator that will hide our error message. So we'll create an empty function, hide error. And this is going to return an action object with a type property of hide error. I want to expose hide error on our exports. So at the top of actions.js, we'll add the hide error function as part of the export. And as always, we need to handle this case in our reducer. So we'll go back to index.js. And I'm going to add a case for hide error. And we're going to handle that case by returning an updated version of the state. And this time we set isError to false and error message to an empty string. So now I'm going to go into the error message tag. And we're going to wire up a hyperlink that will trigger hiding the message. So we'll add an href that goes nowhere with an onClick handler. Points to a function called hideMessage. We'll add the hideMessage function to a set of script tags at the bottom of errorMessage tag. And we're going to call this.ops.hide. And hide is going to be a function that's passed into the errorMessage tag from todoApp. So back in todoApp.tag, we'll add the hideErrorMessage function. And hideErrorMessage we'll call store.dispatch and pass it in actions.hideError. So now we need to pass this in as our hide attribute on the error message tag. So go back up here. We'll add our hide attribute and we'll pass in hide error message. Now we can go back to our browser, refresh, and trigger that error. I get my message and you'll see that I have my link here. And I click that and it hides my message. So let's take this error scenario one step further and make this a slightly better experience for our end user. Rather than forcing them to click the X to get out of the error message, we'll hide it after a set amount of time. So to do that, we're going to go into actions.js. We're going to add a new async action creator. We'll call that temp error message, and we'll have it accept message as an argument. And like our other async action creators, it'll return a function that accepts dispatch and get state as arguments. And we're going to call dispatch show error, and we're going to pass the message through. And now to handle hiding the error message, we're going to add a set timeout and we're going to set our timeout to 1 second. And in that set timeout, we're going to call dispatch to hide our error. So now when we get an error, the message should show up immediately. And then after a second, our message should be hidden if we haven't hidden it already. And now let's replace our call to show error with a call to temp error message. So in our toggle complete function where we get the error response, we replace that dispatch and call temp error message instead of show error. And if we go into our browser and refresh, we should be able to click record video, get our error message, and after a second goes by, our error message disappears. Thank you for watching.